Chris with BBTV, and I'm joined by Big John Fury. How are you, John? It's great to see you again.
How are you, mate? Good to see you.
Very good. It was good having that chat yesterday with you as well. We had a off camera, obviously, and we didn't film any, but yeah, it was really good.
It was all right.
We were talking about some of your pro career, really, and I said I'd been at some of your fights, and I had a look. I've been to actually three of your fights.
A long time ago, Chris. We're both getting on in years now, Paul.
We're knocking on a bit.
35 years ago. Yeah. You know, so a long time, but what career I had was someone, you remember me, Chris. There was no proper training, was there? No gym work, no conditioning proper, was there? You just do your work in the day, roll up on a night time, fight and get a few quid, wasn't it? Yeah. You know, wherever the road took you, you went, didn't you? That were it. But there was no money. We were boxing for 200 quid, weren't we? You know, I had 13 or 14 pro fights. I never made £4,000 out of the lot. So it just shows you a waste of time. But like I say, all that had to take place to give me the knowledge and to bring us to where we're at today and to handle this younger generation, which thank God it's all going well.
Because you had no amateur career, and you'd done the bare knuckle stuff, but you just jumped right in there and into the pros, working in the day, training at night, and then fighting at the weekend.
My life contested when I was younger, fighting outside of clubs, fighting when you lost your temper with your mates, fighting when somebody insulted you, you know, so on. It goes from there, don't it? But it's been a world of war, isn't it? You know what, it'll never end till the day you shut your eyes, because there's always something and always somebody to disrespect you, no matter who you are and no matter what you do in life. So that's life, we can deal with it.
But you know, maybe your boxing career didn't go how you would have liked, maybe, but you know, when you, in hindsight, all them years forward, look at now, you're the father of the heavyweight champion of the world, and you know, you've got your two lads here, Tommy and Roman, then pros now, and you know, it's so boxing as it was there, and it's here more than ever in your life, so it's always a mainstay.
You've got to enjoy it, and I enjoyed it then, no matter what the outcome. I never took it too seriously because I like doing it, and stuff you love doing, you'll do it anyway, no matter what the result is. Win, lose, or draw, you always come back for the next episode, don't you? And that was a story of my life, but you know what? Couldn't have turned out better, could it? You know, late on in life's been good to me. I've had a rocky road. I still got a pretty rough life. Like, I don't do nothing spectacular. I don't live the flash life, you know. I'm very, very humbly living, let's say, you know what I'm saying? But like I say, it suits me, and I live to how I like to live, and I'm not bothered about anything else. I drive old cars. I spend most of my life in a shepherd's hut, you know what I'm saying, in the summer months. Wherever I can get, I can get. I like my fires outside. I like my fry up outside. I'm not going to change, because all of them in the world can't change me. And what I see of money, it can cause a lot of problems, can't it? And the problems it's caused in my life, I don't really want it, you know. I can do without it. As long as I can pay my bills, put fuel in my car and feed myself, I'm happy enough, man. Yeah. All them up want it, let them go and get it, because no good comes of it. And my father used to say that you can have too much. Have peaches and cream every day for a month, you don't want to know, do you? You won't want to look at it. Same with that life. Look at all the movie stars, all these top people have all got problems, haven't they? And you know what, I'm sot here today, you know, I ain't got any problems, you know, because I don't create them. I've got no big wealth, I don't want big wealth, so I've got no real headaches. And when you've got big businesses, you've got responsibilities coming out your ear end, problems. You're walking out, you're head naffed all day long. I don't want to do that. I'm closer to 60 than 50. I just want to relax. And if I won the lottery now, it wouldn't change my life. Because it's too late for me. I've had my life. 3 score, 1 year and 10. If I'm lucky, I might get the other 10. But well, you never know. No one knows the day or the hour, only God. No. True. You know, if he spares me, he spares me. And if not, there's a lot of people on the other side I love. I'll see them. I'm sure of it.
But you're enjoying life.
I do,
John, yeah. You know, since obviously Tyson's become heavyweight champion, your life's took a real trajectory, hasn't it? You probably must get noticed everywhere you go. People wanting pictures, autographs, which is lovely, but you know, you've now become a household face and a name, and people, you know, how have you took to that? I mean, you know, I'm sure Tyson's had to deal with that. I'm sure that's another. But yourself, you know.
All I can say to that, Chris, is I feel a bit selfish, really, because I'm not an Instagram man. I'm not an internet man. I'm not a glass phone man. You've seen me phone. And I want to apologise to all my fans, because if they think I've not followed them back, or I've not done this, I've not done that, it's because I can't. I'm very dyslexic with stuff like that. And like I said before, I can't get out of my old ways. I can't let the past go, you know. And simplicity for me, I like the old Nokia 3310. You know, I can work it, I can see it. It don't go off in my pocket. I'm not having a conversation, I'm driving on the road and not know I'm having a conversation. You know, I press the end button or the on button, I'm done. You know, and I just want to apologise, but to the people who follow me, but no harm meant. You know, love them all, and thank you for the support for me and my sons. You know, and I can't say any more really, but I'm an old-fashioned guy. What can you do, you know? But I love them all, I love all people. People who love me, I love them more. You know, you can't say any more, can you? And you're always going to have your haters, you're always going to have the ones that disagree with you, but that's life, unfortunately, isn't it? But I wish them all well, even the haters, I wish them well. I wish them all the luck in the world, and because life's too short. But it's nice to be nice, isn't it, with everybody? You know, if you can be polite and nice, it's better than being hostile and horrible, isn't it, to people? Especially when we're approaching the times we're living in now, you know, where everything's uncertain, nothing's what it seems, you know. So if you can be nice to people, it's a plus, isn't it? Don't you think so?
Absolutely, John. You know, you've got a goal to come back sometimes, you know, in situations, life's like that, you know, a lifetime of experiences, and you get to a certain age, you look back, you wouldn't change certain things, but it makes you who you are, and, you know.
I'd change the hostilities in my life, you know.
Yeah, these things you look back on with a bit of, you know, we all have got them, haven't we?
We've got them, but they're only self-inflicted, aren't they? Yeah. I always say, bad company and fake friends can cause you a problem. And probably that was the biggest part of my life. The problem was hanging around the wrong lot, you know. But if you're around the right company, on the, you're on the same page as those people, you're never going to have a problem, are you? It's always the one just sat in the company of what's probably envious of what you've got. They want to be like you and can't, so they want to present problems, but in a sly way, you know. But the problem with me and the way my mindset is, I can detect them problems in the blink of an eye. And I just feel myself getting aggravated, and before it'd be that grabbing the ear. But now I just look up and say, yep, quick hello and a faster goodbye. Good luck, mate, I'll pray for you. It works, and I feel better by doing it. Instead of cracking somebody near or they crack me back, it's not nice, but sometimes in the younger days, that was the norm, you know, especially in the 80s. When we was all young, you know what I'm saying, the late 70s, early 80s, my God almighty. Life was hostile then, wasn't it? You know, it was in the time with the skinheads, you know, the teddy boys are still around. You know, you had the mods, the rockers, and they all wanted to be...
Everyone had a scrap.
They all wanted to be powerhouses, didn't they? And 9 times out of 10, they was. Yeah. And we had more punch-ups when we were kids than soft mick, you know, because that was the environment we was living in. But now, everybody's quiet, aren't they? You know, it's... really do much, time, can you? Yeah. Can't say no. If you raise your voice, you're a bad guy. You know, I don't know. I think the energy's been drained out of life in this new generation we're living in. You see, the people, like, they don't seem to be alive, do they? So if I look at somewhere and raise my voice, they're like that. Back in the day, people lean to you, wouldn't they? They'd lean to you and want to listen. You know, but now everybody feels threatened. Yeah. You know, everything's got to be said and done politely and mildly. You know, because people get offended over nothing. And what wasn't a crime then's a crime now. And what wasn't a crime today was a crime then. So it's all mixed up. But you know what, I keep out of it, you know, Chris. I'm not interested in it. As long as people's doing well in life and they're healthy and they've got no problems and they're getting up with a smile on their face, you can't ask for no more, can you? You know, so it's all good stuff, but there's a lot wrong with it. But again, I'm an old-fashioned man with old morals. And will I change? No. And I don't want to. Because that, you know, polite, timid way of walking about, it don't suit men like me, does it? You know, not in what we do for a living. you know, especially in the fight game. And it's only in the boxing world, you come to these rough, tough gyms, where I can see flashbacks of the old days, because I can't see it nowhere else. But I don't go nowhere else. I don't hang around in crowds. I don't go to pubs. I don't go to clubs. I don't do funerals. I don't do weddings. I don't do christenings. I don't do anything anymore, because I feel out of place. And you don't want to put yourself in a position where, you know, you'll probably get upset, you'll be depressed over the way things are, because times have changed. And when you go out and about in the world, you can see the difference massively, and I'll probably get depressed over it, because I always look to the old life. Always look to the old ways, because the old ways were the best. We had a lot less, but you had a lot more, because you knew where you was with everybody. But now, no one's your friend, are they? Unless there's that. And if you don't that, you're not going to be John Fury. Who can you rely on today? Far and few between.
That's about, yeah.
And the people I could rely on, they're no longer here. They're dead and gone, you know. So it's me on this. And my judgment, that's all I've got left in life. My own self and my own judgment to know genuine people from non-genuine people. But times have made people all want the same thing. Glitter and glamour. And it don't work. And there's no happiness there. There's no bottom to it. There's no nothing. It's all fake stuff. You know, it's like old people who got together years ago, didn't they? You know, and they stayed together till they died, didn't they? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But now even that's all different, you know, because the younger generation today, they don't care about nothing, do they? Only, what can you say? The glitz of what they think life can bring. And if you drive an old car like me, people look at me and have them say to me, get your son to get you a better car. I don't want a better car. It goes, don't it? Cheap insurance. It's only 30 years old, I'm not bothered. So, you know, but I get a buzz out of people looking at me and judging me like that, you know what I'm saying? I just get a buzz, Chris, out of it, because I pray for them, because they're sad, aren't they? If you need a big car, or a big house, or a fancy watch, or a big this, that, and the other, to gain respect, well, you're on the wrong path, aren't you? Totally wrong path, Chris. Can't beat the working class people, salt of the earth, aren't they? They keep the cog going, keep the wheel moving. They're the main cog in the engine, aren't they?
Absolutely.
You know, take the working class people out, there'd be no millionaires, would they? Because all the working class people make them rich, don't they? Yeah. So they want to give a bit more respect to the more humble working class. Yeah. I've got no time for the rich people, to be honest.
There's no substance in that.
That's why I say to Tyson, you know, with all the money he's got, never forget who you are and where you come from. You're a raggle-taggle gypsy, and that's what you'll stay. You was born that way, you'll stay that way. And when you think you can mix with these people, what's been brought up that way, generation after generation, you'll never get accepted. They'll think you're a fake, they'll think you're an idiot, and they call you new money, don't they? You know, new money or old money. If you got it in your pocket, you are what you are, you're rich or poor. If it's in there, you're rich, and if it's not, you're poor. Simple, isn't it? But stick to who you are. Never have a face where you want to be humble, then you want to be head in the clouds being clever, because then people lose respect for you, don't they? Always be yourself. Money don't make the man. And I tell you, people will respect a rich man who's never changed more than a poor man who's become rich and he's changed, because you become somebody else and you don't fit that bill, do you? Just because you got a few quid. You know, so I say, listen, stay as you are. If you've been lucky enough to have some good friends in your life, stick with them. You know, because new brooms don't sweep clean, do they? And be a man of your word, you know, and a yes be yes, and you know be no. And you'll get through life a lot easier, a lot quicker, with more respect from everybody. But when you're genuine, even the people who don't like you'll have to say, well, you know what? What can you say? Genuine enough bloke. You know what I'm saying? Look, got my son's shoes on. He left them in the back of the van. I liked them. I thought they're comfy. I'm taking them.
All right, then.
Yeah. I'm taking them.
Can I at least put them back?
Yeah, of course.
Oh, hey, love you, all right? Getting the session in?
Yeah.
Good for you.
In these places, John, this is where you'll find you. This is pretty much where you'll find me. The boxing gym's when I'm coming out. You know, I'd rather be here now than at the old weighing today
and
nothing and all that, you know.
What have we got left? What have we got left, mate? Only to do what we do. This is, I've done this all my life from being a very, very young man. The first gym I walked in was Brendan Ingalls' gym in Sheffield, and the year was 1978.
Take us back to that day.
Yeah, I was 12 year old, and you know, there's all these fighters that seemed to be a full place. It was like everybody was on top of one another, everybody jumping around, everyone having a good time, and it was good. You know, I remember the old boy saying, yeah, I was walking up and down the lines, and I thought, this is a boring job, this. There's some yellow lines, I always remember it in his gym, and you had to keep putting your one foot there, up there, up there. And that went on for about an hour. I thought, when we're going to hit the bag, when we're going to do the pads, when we're going to spar, and that never come. And I thought, I'd tell with this, and I'm out of here. And we never went back for another 10 years. And then we went back, and it was Tyson time. By then, you know what I'm saying, time we went back, so I went back briefly 10 years later, and another 10 years had passed, and obviously went back with Tyson. That was the first memory of a boxing gym for me. You know, did we do anything? No. Just like the smell of it and the look of it. But I want to go and hit the bag, spar, and do some things like you do. As a 12-year-old, you want to do everything, don't you?
Yeah, yeah.
And you didn't get it there and then, it wasn't worth waiting for, in my book then. Too many things to do, too young, and a head full of ideas, and in a rush to put them into play. That was my biggest problem when I was younger. But listen, we are what we are.
You went into Brian Hughes' gym, didn't you, as a young man as well?
Yeah.
So the old Brendan's and
I've known them all since I was a pup.
Yeah.
You know, since I was a pup. You know, I went into Brian Hughes when I was about 20, 21. Remember Daniel Orford, cruiserweight. You know, there's loads of people in there.
You know, but just start with Pat, was telling us that story when Brian put you in with him because he was getting a bit too, thinking he didn't have to train 2 hours, so get him in with John.
All's Pat done with me is use me as a punch bag. He was a class act, Pat Barrett. Man was a world class fighter, you know. I was only a bill filler, wasn't I? You know, I've got a lot of respect for Pat. He was a great fighter. You know, unlucky not to be a world champion. You know, and he's got a good gym, trains his lads well. He's always been respectful to me as Pat. When I was locked up with him, he was the only friend I probably had in jail then. He used to bring me bananas and stuff like that, bits of fruit, chocolate, biscuits. A real good guy, but I've known him all my life. I've known Pat since we were kids, and Pat's my age. You know, but I tell you what he is, he's as sound as a pound.
Top man,
he's a genuine man, Pat. You know, I've got a lot of time for him. And he's part of my life, isn't he?
Yeah.
Part of my life is Pat.
Yeah.
Good memories with him. God bless you, Pat. Good luck to you, mate.
Yeah,
I'll come in and see you soon.
Yeah.
I will and all.
You fought in a few of the same bills.
We did. I always remember Pat when he fought, I think it was at the Midland Hotel. And in the afternoon, he's eating fish and chips. That's what you're doing with them. Oh, I'm eating me grub. And he had a great physique, and he fought a man called Sugar Jibbleroo, and he got a draw. Cracking fight.
Oh,
what a scrap that. You know, but he was a no-nonsense man. He'd have a bag of chips, Pat. He'd have a Mars bar and get in and do that.
Yeah.
You know.
No, he was some
cracking.
Fighter.
Be a good fighter.
Yeah,
remember
he had two
that.
Fights with Sugar Jibbleroo.
Yeah, all stuck in my mind forever and a day.
Yeah.
But he was always good value for money, Pat, weren't he?
He was.
Great fighter. There's all good back in them days. Old school, see?
Yeah.
Back to what you were saying.
Yeah. What was I saying? Oh, yeah, about Tyson saying, you know, going back. But
yeah.
It's been a real whirlwind, hasn't it? You know, you think from them days, it doesn't seem long ago when I think back to when he was an amateur. Has it felt like that,
It's been 20 years, it's gone. You know, when Tyson first started boxing.
What he's achieved in them, you know what you think?
He first started when he was about 13-year-old, and I blinked, and 20 years has gone by. He's been a pro nearly 20 years, you know. So he had his first fight in 2005. You know, that's 18 years ago. You know, so. But look where he's come. You know, for a man like him to come out of a wretch like me, it's something, isn't it, to be proud of? You know what I'm saying? And his mother can be proud of him as well, you know, because where. In the world does it happen to people? And you know what, it's like I said to him the other day, it's even put me on some kind of a platform, even though I'm nobody, even though I know it's all because of my son, we know that, but it's still given me this kind of a platform where I can reach people and help people myself and advise them. Okay. And it's nice when people want your opinion, isn't it? Like before, I could just walk down the road, nobody keep away from that club, they'd like walk around me, you know what I'm saying? It'd be a quick hello and a fast goodbye, hello and goodbye. But now, the benefits are, people want to stop, talk to me and listen, because they think they can learn something, and they can. Because sometimes a fool can make a wise suggestion. And I know I'm a fool, but I'm a clever fool. You know, and at the end of the day, nobody knows everything. And I probably tripped up and fell over more times than anybody else. Look at the state of my past. It's a checkered past, to say the least. But listen, I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing, but I just had problems finding the right time and the right place to do these things. And now, through my son being where he is, has given me that platform now to slow myself down. I've got plenty of time to enjoy. So that's where I am with it. You know, I want nothing out of it because I've been paid, and I've been paid. Look where Tommy is. He's, everybody knows him, he's world famous. Tyson, he's in orbit with fame, the best heavyweight on the planet to ever come out of this country. And you know, the best of his era, I'm probably up there with the top five in the world that's ever been. You know, so that's worth $2 trillion for me. You know, and him being my son, it's incredible, isn't it? And I've got, you know, four of the great sons, all successful. You know, so I'm in the driving seat, mate. And it's only us, we don't bother with nobody. It's just me and my six sons. And we stand alone, and we always will do.
You keep it close, tight.
Yeah. Yeah, because we've had that much crap in our life. Keep it tight. You don't get infested with rubbish, do you, and crap. What cause problems. So here's where we're at. We're what they call aware of the problems strangers can cause when they come as wolves in sheep's clothing. But that's what my job is for. I'm on it. Everybody that comes round Tyson, I vet them, I take a look at them, I'm judging them. And I shouldn't judge them, because only God can judge another man. But that's my job, to judge these people, to see whether they mean my son's harm or good. You know, and that's just a dad thing, what dads do. If you're a good dad, you know that, if you've got kids, don't you, Chris? You'll advise them. If I say to my lad, I don't like him, I don't think he's any good lad, he's no good to him, they'll listen at some point. Plant the seed. If somebody tells you, somebody, I'm not sure about him, lad, he's here for all the wrong reasons, they probably won't take it on board then, but at a later date, they've got it. And they'll realise, my dad was right. And you know something? I've not been wrong yet. I'm the biggest crank in the world, you know. I got an odd voice, I come across, I don't know, a bit thick probably at sometimes, but let me tell you something, I've never been wrong. I'm good at judging stuff, and everybody's got a gift, haven't they? You know, no good for nothing else. You know, only producing kids and judging people. Chris, I'm going to have to get on with my work, Chris, honestly, I've got lads here to train, but listen,
yeah.
God bless you, mate.